I stumble back, begin to run away as my fear catches in my throat, emerging as a strangled cry. I alternate between turning around and glancing back over my shoulder, desperate to escape, but unwilling to let the thing out of my sight. Hello everybody, I'm The Rubber. Today, we bring you SCP Foundation Euclid Class Object SCP-3166. SCP-3166 is a 2.1 meter tall humanoid entity, presumed pataphysical in nature, known to manifest during periods when the Garfield media franchise is performing poorly in terms of public reception. The exterior layer of SCP-3166's body resembles a crudely made costume of the character Garfield, which field inspection has shown to be composed of legitimate cat fur. However, analysis of SCP-3166's composition in the field has shown that its interior mass is composed entirely out of pasta, specifically lasagna. SCP-3166 will appear in the vicinity of a suitable individual, hereafter referred to as the target, and move towards their location. Known targets of SCP-3166 have included individuals prominently involved in rival media to the Garfield franchise, individuals formerly involved in the production of the Garfield comic strip, individuals involved in parodies of the Garfield franchise, vocal critics of the Garfield franchise, and last but not least, Garfield creator Jim Davis. This has only occurred on occasions where the negative reception Garfield was receiving could be traced back to Mr. Davis's poor management of the franchise. Upon reaching its target, 3166 will attempt to inflict bodily harm upon them through a mixture of blunt force using nearby objects and force feeding of lasagna. The lasagna was obtained through self-disembowelment. During this process, SCP-3166 will vocalize by meowing, purring, and screeching in the manner of an extremely agitated cat. Lasagna outside SCP-3166's mass has proven to be an effective form of bait for 3166. Upon seeing the lasagna, SCP-3166 will abandon its original goal and instead attempt to incorporate the pasta into itself. SCP-3166 first manifested on the 23rd of October 1989. Within the Chicago offices of United Media, who were the publishers of the Garfield comic strip at the time. Upon manifestation, 3166 wandered around the offices in a confused and distressed manner, before indiscriminately assaulting any individuals present after security attempted to apprehend it. It disappeared 20 minutes later. Foundation agents responding to the situation distributed amnestics as appropriate. Over the course of the following week, similar manifestations took place at several United Media offices around the country, ending on the 29th of October 1989. Following that date, 3166 altered its behavior to its current form. The week of Garfield comic strips below, beginning on the 23rd of October 1989, was believed to be its pataphysical awakening. Day 1, the 23rd of October 1989. Garfield woke up from a sleep and felt an eerie sensation. As he was walking out of his room, he did not feel right, as if the place was not his own home. Day 2, the 24th of October, 1989. He felt lonely because the house was empty. John was not home, and so was Odie. Day 3, the 25th of October, 1989. Garfield thought to himself, John must be at the grocery. There was a for sale sign outside of his house, and the house looks like it had been abandoned for a long time. Day 4, the 26th of October 1989. Garfield had the shock of his life. If the house had been abandoned for a long time, it means that he has not lived there for many years. Day 5, the 27th of October 1989. Garfield welcomed John and Odie, and they brought home his food. However, this was entirely Garfield's imagination. Garfield grappled with his greatest fear, loneliness. Day 6, the 28th of October, 1989. This strip started with a drawing of a horrified eye, and it wrote, "After years of taking life for granted, Garfield is shaken by a horrifying vision of the inevitable process called time." Garfield cried out, "I don't want to be alone." At the corner end of the comic strip wrote, and imagination is a powerful tool. It can tint memories of the past, shape perceptions of the present, or paint a future so vivid that it can entice or terrify, all depending upon how we conduct ourselves today. Initially, individuals involved with production of Garfield comic strips claimed to have no memory on working on that week's strips. All researchers working on 3166 containment are to familiarize themselves on this material. Using tissue samples taken by Agent Mueller during SCP-316's most recent manifestation, genetic analysis of the meat present within the lasagna has shown it to be genetically identical to Garfield creator Jim Davis. The implications of this are currently unclear. However, during surveillance of Mr. Davis by containment teams, he has complained of severe mosquito bites in the night, on a number of occasions immediately preceding 3166 manifestation. In order to contain 3166, the Garfield media franchise is to remain active and successful for as long as feasibly possible. Funding is to be provided to any Garfield media ventures via Foundation front companies present in the comic and film industries. Agents embedded within Pulse Incorporated, which is the sole owner of the rights to Garfield, and Andrews McMeel Syndication, primary distributors of the Garfield comic strip, are to place targeted memetic agents in outgoing comic strip, encouraging the retention of a sizable Garfield fan base and discouraging Jim Davis from discontinuing Garfield. Agents are to monitor individuals at significant risk of attack from 3166. In the event of a 3166 manifestation, agents are to use supplied frozen lasagna to lure 3166 away from its target and dispatch it once out of public view. Any witnesses are then to be administered amnestics as appropriate for their level of exposure. The below article is an associated tale written by I Am the Oga on the 30th of August of 2018. I walk down the street on my way home after a long night. It's not yet fully raining, but there's still a slight drizzle about. I put on my waterproof jacket, but while it keeps me dry, it does nothing against the chill of the quiet night air. The office wasn't a pleasant place today. Apparently, the strip isn't doing so well, and the numbers are going down. Being a new hire is rough. I cannot say that the fading popularity surprises me. It's been the same stale strip for years now. But apparently, some investors were really upset. Some suits were prowling around today, asking questions and taking names. I stop for a minute, pulling out my phone to confirm a sneaking suspicion. Yep, I went the wrong way. I shouldn't be anywhere near the park. It is easy to get lost in the rain. I sigh and turn around, resigning myself to another miserable 10 minutes of slogging through the rain. There is a figure in front, standing quietly under the street lamp. I stop again, mildly unsettled by this. I call out to him, asking if he is okay, but no response comes. Instead, the figure begins to plod forward, taking a step into the light. The baggy suit slumps and sags with each step. The matted orange fur too dirty to be slicked down by the rain. The lazy-eyed face is at an angle, crudely propped up upon the head, swaying as it advances. The tail drags in the puddles, only adding on to the stains already coating it and the rest of the body. It raises the old baseball bat it carries, picking up speed. I stumble back, begin to run away as my fear catches in my throat, emerging as a strangled cry. I alternate between turning around and glancing back over my shoulder, desperate to escape, but unwilling to let the thing out of my sight. It thumps the bat against the fence as it runs, sickening thwack sounding with each blow. Too focused on the beast, I did not avoid the puddle, and my foot slides out from under me, sending me crashing to the ground. As the world whirls around me, seeing nothing but darkness and rain, a low, agonized meow sounds from above me, immediately followed by a crushing blow to the hip. I scream out in pain, but as I gasp for breath, a horrible, wet, tearing noise fills the air, accompanied by another guttural screech. Then, a dripping, slimy mass is slammed into my face, and my monstrous assailant begins forcing fistfuls more down my throat. Man, I hate Mondays. Before we end this video, we are proud to present these incredibly sweet pieces of fan art. a big thank you to all of you. You can now send us your fan art, and we will be more than happy to show off your best art piece in our next video. Check out our description below on how to submit. I hope you enjoyed today's video. Which SCP do you want to see in the next video, and why it is interesting? Let us know in the comment below. We will draw your story and share it with the world. Don't forget to click like, subscribe to the channel, and hit the bell. Please share it to your friends if you like this video. Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you in the next video. Bye-bye!